Amy Werkheiser with the River, a Wesleyan church here in Minong and Solon Springs, Wisconsin. I hope you enjoyed that sample of Conte Patiro, also known as Time to Say Goodbye, sung by Andrea Bocelli and Sarah Brightman. Thanks for tuning in with us today to finish up our teaching series on Hebrews. It's been an amazing journey, seeing the supremacy of Christ over all things, the seriousness in which the writer contends for us to keep the faith through difficult times, and the encouragement that comes through having a community of believers dedicated to one another. In the spirit of ending this great letter, I want to share with you some great letters I found on the internet written by kids. Our first letter seems to be from some very disgruntled youngin who just needs some time to sort out his feelings. He writes, "I'm angry at you. I'm not talking to you today and tomorrow. P.S. All day. P.S.S. I still love you." Now, I've got to give this kid props, though. Most kids, when they're angry, haul off with every parent's dreaded phrase, "I hate you." This kid understands that you can be angry with someone and still love them. Our next letter is for the jolly old Saint Nick himself. "Dear Santa, I wanted to tell you I am fine. I don't know if you can, but could you possibly make it so I can turn into a dragon, please? Or a pet dragon. Either one will do. Though I would like it if you can make me turn into a dragon. P.S. Have a happy Valentine's Day. Love, Elisha." I see what Elisha's playing at. Wishing Santa a happy Valentine's Day so he can butter that old man up and get those dragon-changing abilities. Why did I never think of that? Would have saved a fortune on gas and airline tickets. In our next letter, we've got another disgruntled kid. Seems to be kind of a trend or something. It reads, "Mom, I'm going to run away tomorrow at 9:30 when you and Dad are sleeping. Be sure to say goodbye forever. Emily. P.S. I will be packing tonight." Ooh, that does sound serious. I wonder if Emily meant 9:30 a.m. or p.m. I hope her parents didn't assume the wrong time and miss out on their chance to say goodbye forever. You know, once I was going to run away, I started getting things together and making ham sandwiches while angrily plotting out my journey. But packing is hard, and I got lazy, and I gave up on my ambition to run away within a half an hour or so. I wonder how long Emily lasted. Now, our last letter was actually written in the form of a poem. Some context was given along with the posting of the letter that I'll share with you. This ancient letter can be traced all the way back to 1981 from a young girl named Leanne. Leanne's sister, Patty, was 6 years older than her and loved to play tennis against the garage door. And of course, ignore Leanne's request to play together. Enjoy the dynamic reading of My Sister Patty S., dated April 15, 1981. "My sister pretends not to see and tries to hit me. Sometimes she hits the ball low, but never slow. She hits really hard, like a retard. She uses a racket and ball and thinks She knows it all. Tennis is the game, and I think she's insane. By Leanne S. P.S. I just read her this poem, and now I'm going to get thrown. Besides being hilarious and written by kids, all these letters have something else in common. That's right, you guessed it. They all had P.S. messages at the end. We're all familiar with the P.S.s that come at the end of letters. You know, where you wrote P.S., check no, check yes, if you like me, in your elementary school love letters, or P.S., you may be an instant winner, from Publishers Clearinghouse. I bet you have to stop for a moment, though, and think about what P.S. actually means. I know I did. P.S. stands for postscript, from the Latin postscriptum, meaning written after. The postscript can be something added to the end as an afterthought, or it can merely be some final thoughts written after the main work was completed. Hebrews chapter 13 is a lot like a postscript. After receiving our main body of teaching and points the author wished to make, our unknown author makes a series of small commands and reminders to instruct the audience. The commands given in Hebrews 13 appear to be random or unconnected at times. But that really shouldn't surprise us. That's exactly the kind of thing we would expect from a postscript. There are these random, oh yeah, I need to mention this before I stop writing, kind of things. It might even be something not previously mentioned in the letter at all. Chapter 13's content functions very much like a postscript indeed. The content of chapter 13 is a list of moral reminders for fellow believers after the main teaching. This was a pretty common thing for the writers of the New Testament to do. Many of Apostle Paul's letters, like Romans, Galatians, and Ephesians, contain a list of morals and points after the main arguments that Paul was to present. I mention all this because, though it may seem like Hebrews 13 is random and out of place to us, it likely wouldn't have seemed so random and out of place to the original audience of the day. Now, before we dive into our verse-by-verse discussion, I want to read the passage to you. I'll be using the New International Version 2011 throughout today's study, but you're of course welcome to use any version that you like. Hebrews, chapter 13, New International Version, 2011. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without even knowing it. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as you yourselves were suffering. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. Keep your lives free from the love of money, and be content with what you have, because God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." So we say this with confidence, "The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?" Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do so. We have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make people holy through his own blood. Let us, then, go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. And do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased. Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you. Pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience and desire to live honorably in every way. I particularly urge you to pray so that I might be restored to you soon. Now, may the God of peace, who, through the blood of the eternal covenant, brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I urge you to bear with my word of exhortation, for in fact, I have written to you quite briefly. I want you to know that our brother Timothy has been released. If he arrives soon, I will come with him to see you. Greet all your leaders and all the Lord's people. Those from Italy send you their greetings. Grace be with you all. Our first verse is, keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. The author reminds us now that we're family in Christ, and loving one another is a primary calling that God has laid upon us. It's not optional. It's a command. If we think back to Hebrews 10:25, we're encouraged not to give up the habit of meeting together. Meeting together is where love happens. It's hard to fulfill God's command to love one another if we don't even meet together. Also important to note is that the letter is full of encouragement not to fall away from the true faith. Being in community with one another can help keep us strong and help us persevere. I don't think this is said enough, but here it is. The Christian life is hard. Choosing to become a disciple of Jesus is not going to make your life easier. Many will attest to this. It's better, but it certainly isn't easier. In following Christ, we're learning how to serve him instead of ourselves. We're learning that the values and desires that our society holds on a pedestal are nothing but a vain shadow. Walking the path of Christ is a complete reversal of the things we've known, and change is difficult. Having a loving community of believers is necessary, and intentionally God's design to help us grow and keep our faith. Verse 2 says, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Showing hospitality was considered a prime virtue in ancient times, but it's not considered so much today to be as valuable. However, the Bible challenges our culture's understanding of that. Our author points out that when we're giving hospitality to strangers, you never quite know who you're helping or what God is doing. If you read through the Old Testament, there were multiple encounters like this. Gideon and Lot both entertained angels without even knowing it. But the most famous example, and likely the one the author is thinking about, is Abraham in Genesis 18. One day, three visitors passed by, and Abraham invited them into his own tent to refresh themselves. He prepared snacks and drinks for them and did his best to make them comfortable. It was these guests that told Abraham and Sarah they were finally going to have the child that they waited so long to have. What a word of encouragement Abraham would have missed if he would have just let the strangers go by. How might we show hospitality to strangers today? we can invite our neighbors, you know, the ones we haven't actually taken the time to get to know, and it's been a few years now. We could invite them over for dinner. We could help a stranger struggling to get their groceries in the car. There are lots of things we could do to show hospitality in this day and age. So let's make sure the opportunities don't pass us by. Verse 3, continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering. Likely we're talking about Christians who have been thrown in jail for their faith in this context. The first 300 some years after Christ walked the earth was not an easy environment for the church to blossom. Waves of persecution from the governmental authorities were commonplace. And when we read throughout the New Testament, many believers like Paul, Peter, John, and others were imprisoned for their faith in Christ. Now, it was critical that believers remembered those in prison because the state did not supply the major needs a prisoner would have. Things like food, clothes, writing materials would have to be brought in by a family member or friend. There were no color TVs, no books, no workout gym, no basketball courts in ancient prisons. Today's prisons look like the Hilton compared to prisons our author's talking about. Now, something interesting I read is that Christians were very early on known for their care for prisoners. They, of course, would be taking care of those in the community of believers that who have been jailed for their faith, but they would also care for those who have been imprisoned for other means. What an opportunity it is to be able to speak to those who, because of their circumstances, are at the point where they realize their life needs to change. What if you could introduce them to the one who brings new life? The early Christians saw the opportunity, and so should we. In our day and age in America, we don't have people going to prison merely for sharing the gospel. What this author is talking about is foreign to us, but we should also remember that it isn't like that everywhere in the world. In many countries, it's a crime to preach Christ, and even a crime to convert to Christianity. For example, Reverend Yi Wang of China, who led a major church in the city of Chengdu, has recently been in prison for 9 years for preaching the faith. Let's remember him and others like him in our prayers and in our giving. Verse 4. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. Whether we're married, never married, had been married, engaged to be married, know someone who is married, we should all support and celebrate the marriages in our community. We should have respect for those marriages and seek for each of them to grow and prosper. We should not undermine marriages with gossip, slander, or lack of encouragement and support. We should not flirt, create inappropriate emotional attachments, or cross boundaries with married individuals. Marriage is a special promise between a man and a woman that God designed from the beginning. Our author encourages us to get in alignment with God's plan and support those who are married. The author is not trying to say that marriage is better than being single, but he or she is trying to say that marriage should be honored, respected, and supported in our communities. Marriage is not an easy endeavor, and we, the church, should be a place that strengthens and encourages married partners. The author's admonishment for purity would have not been strange for women to hear in the ancient world. They were always expected to stay to the straight and narrow, but it would have been strange for men. Greco-Roman men, and even Jewish men, had a culture of marital unfaithfulness via pornography, prostitution, and divorce. Our author of Hebrews says, "No more." That is not how the people of God were designed to live by their Creator. The author warns us that God will judge those who violate the design and purpose that God created for human sexuality. Verse 5 and 6. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." So we say this with confidence. The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? We're warned on multiple occasions in the Bible not to love money, such as in Ecclesiastes 5:10 or 1 Timothy 6:10. We're also told that we can only have one master, one thing we can be dedicated to. It cannot be both God and money, as we hear from Jesus in Matthew 6:24. We are encouraged to be content, to be satisfied with what we have. The reason we might love money so much is because we're discontent with what we have. How many times have you wished you had more money for a better TV, to take a bigger vacation, or frankly, if you're like me, to have a car that doesn't have four windows that can't be rolled down, and a suspicious rattle when accelerating above 45 miles per hour? As difficult as it can be not to have everything we want, we're still told not to make money our number one priority. In Matthew 6:33, Jesus tells us that when we make him and his kingdom our number one priority, he'll make sure the rest of our needs are fulfilled. Likewise, we're told at the end of Hebrews 13 verse 5 that God is the one who will carry us through these difficult times, not money. Just as God promised his people he would care for them and provide for them in Deuteronomy 31:6, God still takes care of us and provides for our needs today. Now, I'm not saying that God is going to make life a cushy, rainbows and sunshine vacation for us all the time. He never promised that. Apostle Paul can attest to that in Philippians 4:11-13. Paul experienced the extremes of having plenty and wanting for nothing, to being cold, homeless, hungry, and beaten down. What God does promise us is that through it all, he'll bring us faithfully to the end of the race, so that when we meet Jesus face to face, he'll say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Verse 7. Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Our author encourages us to think about the leaders and those who have taught us, respecting them and praying for them. We should examine their lives, looking for good fruit. If they are growing in Christ, then we should follow their example. One of my favorite quotes of all time comes from the Chinese philosopher Confucius. He said, "By three methods we may learn wisdom. First, by reflection, which is the noblest. Second, by imitation, which is the easiest. And third, by experience, which is the bitterest." Imitating others who are succeeding and learning from their ways is a wise and easier way to learn wisdom than by learning it from the school of hard knocks for ourselves. Also, we could look back to Hebrews 11, often known as the Hall of Faith. We can be encouraged by all the examples of everyday, messed up people who God used mightily because they trusted in him. Imagine what God will do through you if you put your trust in him. Verse 8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Praise God. He does not change. He already is perfect, so a change wouldn't do him any good. God's character and the things he desires do not change. He is a stable, unshifting, firm foundation upon which we can build our lives. It reminds me of the parable of the wise and the foolish builders found in Matthew 7. Those who built their house upon temporary things, money, talent, other people, will soon discover that those things can shift, change, and fade away. Those who built their home upon the rock, upon Christ, have built upon an unchanging foundation that will never perish. Verse 9. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods. which is of no benefit to those who do so. Because Christ is the same, as we saw in our last verse, his message is the same. The gospel message hasn't changed. Therefore, we shouldn't fall for these strange teachings that change things. False teachings have always been a problem throughout church history, from the very beginning years to today. The tricky thing with false teaching is that they often sound good at first. They often do contain an element of truth to them, but it's twisted in such a way that it is no longer the truth that was intended. The early Christians struggled against a group of false teachers that we call the Judaizers. This is a name that we made up for them because it describes what they were doing. The Judaizers would try to take Old Testament laws and practices that God said was unnecessary now that Jesus Christ came. And they would try to make Christians follow those Old Testament Jewish laws and practices again when they didn't need to. Our author tells us that we should be strengthened, building our relationship with God based on the grace that Jesus gives. Instead, the Judaizers were telling people that they had to follow the Old Testament laws, like following certain food laws and regulations. False teaching that appears to be Christian often looks like this. You need Christ and something else to be saved. You need Christ and Old Testament law. You need Christ and good works to earn your salvation. You need Christ and to be a member of our church, etc., etc., etc. We are saved by grace through faith alone. Sola fide in Latin. Now, Paul writes this, and I'm sure our Hebrews author would agree. It was fine for Jewish Christians to be proud of their customs and heritage, but they were no longer the way that God asked people to follow. There was a new covenant and a whole new system of what God wanted to see from people. Verse 10. We have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. Under the old covenant, God allowed the priests of the temple to eat the meat from certain sacrifices. The sacrifice of Christ, though, the one that we live under now, is a different kind of sacrifice. It was done by God alone, and we share no honor in making it happen. This serves as one more reminder that the old system, the old way of things, is finished. Verses 11, 12, and 13. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Let us, then, go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. In the Old Testament, under the Old Covenant, the way to be saved was to be a part of the Israelite community and to follow the laws that God gave to the Israelites. Foreigners could join, but they had to enter the community and submit to the laws that God had given. Being outside the Israelite community, the camp, was to be cut off from God. It was death. Outside was with the non-believers. To be outside the community, outside the camp, naturally carried a stigma. That was the place of death and exclusion. When Jesus was crucified and buried, it was done outside the city. The city was where the temple was, and where the celebration was for the Feast of Passover that was taking place on the day Jesus died. Crucifying him outside the city walls was one more statement that the Jewish leaders did not accept him. If we want to join our Lord, this new thing that God was doing through the cross, we're going to have to leave the camp. We're going to have to leave our old way of life behind for the new thing that God is doing. Some will see this as crazy or shameful, but that is where our Lord is, and we will join him. I was researching this verse in a commentary by F.F. Bruce, and he said this: "The future lay not with the camp, but with the Gentile mission. Let them exchange the imagined security of their old associations for the new venture to which Jesus was leading them out. You see, the old way, the camp mentality, is very self-centric. It's about preserving the camp, and everyone on the outside is doomed. Jesus going outside the camp and reaching out is the new mission. Jesus went outside the camp to save the whole world out there and to make all nations his new camp." Verse 14. "For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for a city that is to come." Life on earth is temporary. All the cities and wonders that man has built will eventually fade away. This world is not our permanent home. Most of us will stay only a few decades. Then it is on to greater things. We're looking forward to the new heaven and the new earth that God will build. If you jump back to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10, Abraham was doing the same thing, looking forward to a city whose architect is God. Verses 15 and 16. "Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. And do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased." Sacrifice was a consistent part of the Old Testament way of worshiping God, usually a sacrifice of animals, grains, or other foodstuffs. Slowly, though, the Israelites were recognizing that sacrifice wasn't just about animals or giving up something. Asaph in Psalm 50 recognizes that a true sacrifice is not about animals, but about thankfulness and praise to God. David in Psalm 141 likens sacrifice to prayers given up to God. In Micah 6, we see that more than any sacrifice, God wanted his people to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with their God. Because of Jesus and his sacrifice on the cross, we no longer need to sacrifice animals to temporarily cover our sins. The sacrifice of Jesus has covered it once and for all. Yet, things like prayer, praise, and walking in accordance with the Spirit are sacrifices still acceptable and pleasing to the Lord today. And they indeed can be sacrifices. Life isn't always easy, and it can be hard to say, "Praise God, for he is good," when you're in the midst of a crisis. To follow his way and not our own, though it frustrates us to the core, can be a sacrifice. To share your home and your food with someone, even if you're on a tight budget yourself, is a sacrifice. Today's sacrifice of prayer, praise, and obeying him is not to earn our salvation, but to show our love and respect for what God has already done for us. It is a beautiful sacrifice that is pleasing in his sight. Verse 17. "Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you." We're encouraged to have a general confidence and respect for our leaders. Leadership in its purest form is not a cakewalk, a power trip, or a way to profit oneself over others. Leadership is to take on the responsibility and the task of helping others succeed. leaders within the body of Christ will have to give an account of the way they led to Christ himself. It is not an easy task, so our author encourages us to take it easy on them. Help the task be a joy to them, not a burden. The author is also being practical, too. If you annoy someone who's in leadership over you, it's probably not going to go well for you. Now, just as a quick disclaimer, this verse isn't commanding an unhealthy, blind obedience to an authority figure, but it is commanding us to handle the relationship with our leaders with grace, respect, and with an honest, clear style of communication. Verse 18. Pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience and desire to live honorably in every way. This verse is just very specific and timely for the author and the original audience. The author is asking for prayer and wants to be in a good example of faith before others and before God. You know, character is an essential part of the minister's life. For it's easy to undermine any gifts and talents with bad character and a dishonorable and hypocritical lifestyle. Verse 19. I particularly urge you to pray so that I might be restored to you soon. You know, perhaps from the way this verse reads, our author might be in prison or under house arrest. The author is at least separated from his audience and wants to return quickly. It's difficult to know the details specifically, though. Verse 20. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep. Going back to Hebrews 9, we are reminded that the death of Christ, symbolized by his blood, is the last once and all sacrifice. There's no need for another. This is the eternal covenant. It will not be changed or altered. Christ will always be the way to God from now on. And not only did Christ die for us, he raised to life in order to defeat death and to share that new life with us. Jesus is a great shepherd, a great caregiver indeed. John chapter 10 tells us that a good shepherd lays down his life to protect the sheep. That is exactly what Jesus did. Verse 21. Equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Christ Jesus, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. One of the most wonderful things about living in the era of Christ, in the timeline of God's salvation plan, is that we have been given the Holy Spirit. One of the reasons we've been given the Spirit is so he can empower us for doing God's will. Sometimes when we read through the Old Testament and see all the ways God's people disobey and disregard God's law, we get to thinking that, man, they were a bunch of idiots. It's easy for us to judge, isn't it? Here's something to think about. We have the Holy Spirit living inside of us from the moment we put our faith in Christ. The people of the Old Testament generally did not have that gift given to them. Only a few select people were given that honor, and usually to complete a specific task. Most of God's people in the Old Testament did not have the Holy Spirit helping them to obey God. And to think, since the moment of Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit has been poured out to all who would believe. You and I are equipped by God to do his will. Remember what a privilege and a gift that is. Verse 22. Brothers and sisters, I urge you to bear with my word of exhortation, for in fact, I have written to you quite briefly. The author pleads with us, or pleads with the audience, and us too, because we're the secondary audience, to listen to his or her exhortation. Exhortation means encouragement with kind of this connotation of correction, direction, and command. It's the main reason the letter was written in the first place, so that the audience would remember and do these things. I don't know about you, but I kind of laugh at the idea that the author thought he or she wrote quite briefly. 13 chapters of some of the most dense theology and sophisticated Greek in the entire New Testament is called brief. Verse 23. I want you to know that our dear brother Timothy has been released. If he arrives soon, I will come with him to see you. The author of the letter knows Timothy, a companion of Paul and a leader in the church of Ephesus. By the language given here, it sounds like Timothy may have been in prison and was released. This event likely happened during the reign of Emperor Nero, who was known for persecuting Christians. When we think back to the author's admonishment for us to take care of those in prison, the author is likely thinking about people like Timothy. Verse 24. Greet all your leaders and all the Lord's people. Those from Italy send you their greetings. It's typical to send greetings with letters. We do it in our cards and letters today, still. It is a decent possibility that our author is likely in Italy, likely in Rome, at the moment that he or she is writing. Verse 25. Grace be with you all. Grace indeed is what we need. Grace, the undeserved kindness and overflowing power of God in our lives. Grace be with us all. And that brings us to the end of chapter 13 and the end of the letter to the Hebrews. Thanks for tuning in with me, Amy Werkheiser, and the River Church in Minong and Solon Springs, Wisconsin. Blessings to you, and it's time to say goodbye.